I'm going to start this video with a bit of a confession, and that confession is that I don't read military books. Now, I know this is surprising, coming from the guy who made a video talking about why he doesn't talk about the military more, gets made fun of by boomers for my haircut and tattoos all the time, and posts stuff like this on my Instagram, but I knew it was going to come out eventually, so I just thought it would be easier if I told you myself. Now, I will say that I do enjoy military media. I watch a lot of movies, as long as they aren't whatever this is.
I love you, Ben.
Roger that, Sergeant.
And I like watching a lot of random YouTube videos on military history, but it's specifically books that I just don't get into. See, military books have a much different audience in mind than, say, movies, TV shows, or YouTube videos. So movies like Saving Private Ryan and Black Hawk Down, those were made to appeal to as wide an audience as possible while still relatively remaining authentic to the military. TV shows like Generation Kill are really pandering to the veteran community, and that it's a very realistic portrayal of the military that not a lot of civilians would get unless they had experience with the military. The audience for a military book is, I don't know, your dad. And I'm going to explain why I don't really like the books with this guy, whose name I can't fully pronounce, so I'm just going to use his last name, Lacan. And in short, he was a 20th century French psychoanalyst, but more on that later. So I don't want to paint too broad a stroke here, so I'm going to narrow it down a little bit. I'll be talking about two types of military books specifically, event-based and people-based. Event-based is exactly what it sounds like. It's covering an event, or a battle, or a landscape, or really just a thing. It might highlight people or units within that area, but really the people and the units are just driving the story of what everything else is going on, and they don't go into too much detail of the actual people there. It'll more so talk about how a certain operation influenced something else, or how it could have gone wrong or better. The one I'm talking about that I don't really enjoy are the people-based military books. These are ones that highlight specific people or a handful of people, and whatever battle or operation they find themselves in is really just a backdrop to talk about themselves. And these kind of person-based military books have a specific culture that typically surrounds them. And the culture itself is what I struggle with. And they come with a series of expectations that go along with them. And the expectation is typically that you take whatever lesson they learn from their hardship or their struggles in the book, and you try to apply it to your own life. Really, you're kind of supposed to do like a Dr. Steve Brule, what did we learn kind of thing, but instead you're supposed to say things like, the world isn't black and white, but you should always still try to do the right thing, never give up, always be ready for anything, and be tough. They're kind of like self-help books, but with violence and occasional war crimes. And it's not that I don't think these kinds of lessons are useful, or that I don't appreciate them, it's the application and the context of them that I struggle with. I don't think the lesson learned in Sherman's March is going to help me keep my soldiers from using fake dentist appointments as an excuse not to take PT tests. The trials and tribulations of the 101st Airborne during the Battle of the Bulge is great and all, but there's a wrench missing from one of my vehicles, and if I don't find it, I owe the Army $74,980. I guarantee you, when my Bradley breaks down in the middle of the woods because a driver sneezed while making a turn, my first thought isn't going to be, what would Storm and Norman Schwarzkopf do right now? And this is kind of where I get to my point of this, is that these are very specific situations that these people are writing about, and you only learn how they reacted in those, as opposed to being able to apply these lessons for other things, because you really do not know how people will act or react or think in any circumstance whatsoever. And this is where I start to tie in with Lacan. Because yes, these might be written as objectively as they can, but you still just don't know for a myriad of reasons. Even the autobiographical ones are written in a certain way that prevents you from really truly understanding what the person was going through or feeling. And I'm going to explain this using Lacan's register theory. Now, his register theory is made up of three sections, each kind of describing how humans interact with the world. The three areas are imaginary, symbolic, and the real, but we're only going to be talking about the imaginary. Now, the imaginary doesn't mean fake or made up. It generally means having to do with what goes on in a person's mind, how they think and interpret things around them, but mainly how we imagine other people. See, Lacan believed that humans are ultimately and radically alone. Alone in the sense that you will never fully know and understand a human being, even close to the way you know yourself. And he describes this as an intrinsic, unavoidable dimension of existence. And no matter how much you like to call yourself an empath on Facebook, you will only ever have interpretations of the people around you. So how does this tie into me not reading military books? Well, it's important to look at the biases that go into these kinds of books, first of all. And because the audience is who it is, and the general expectations of the book are what they are, the book is written a very specific way usually. So, for example, if the book is trying to teach you courage, typically the perils will either be exaggerated or written in a way that just make everything seem more exciting. And even if they were written by the person who actually experienced them, even that has to be taken into account. A grenade explosion from 50 meters away is a boring puff of smoke. A grenade explosion from 1 meter away might as well be a 500-pound JDAM dropped on your head. But let's assume someone wrote the most objective account of war in history, literally just bullet points and timestamps of exactly what happened. Lacan would say that even this isn't enough. Part of his idea of the imaginary is the effect of tying in language into our perceptions of the world. So say you tell someone that you're cold, and say you tell someone that you really know well that you're cold. That person can only apply their own feelings of cold onto you as a way to try to sympathize how you feel at this very moment. And not only that, but the word cold is just an English speaker's best approximation of a physical sensation that exists outside of speech. Add this to all the different languages of the world, the nuances of dialects and cultural speakings, you start to understand how language itself is just an imperfect system, albeit the best one we got. That is, of course, until Elon Musk plugs all of our brains into the internet, and then we can read each other's minds, at which point I'll release a part two of this video. And so when you combine these ideas, you start to see how Lacan says that we are radically alone. Only interacting with our imperfect interpretations of people based on imperfect languages, expressing imperfect expressions of our feelings. And this is only what applies to perfectly objectively written books. Things start to multiply exponentially when you take into consideration all the other things that happens when someone writes a book. When you consider that the vast majority of these books are not written by the person who experienced them, went through months and months of revisions from editors, publishers, and anyone with a stick in the game to make a dollar off the book, on top of that, they're writing a book about one of, if not the most complex and subjective parts of history, you know, literal war, some details are, they're not gonna be right. And these are the details that you're supposed to be pulling important life lessons from. Now, as many as my viewers know, I do read books, just not military ones. And this is personal preference, but I find books that are generally written more broadly have a lot more things that I can apply every single day, rather than just waiting for the perfect time for me to apply a paragraph that I read. So while, yeah, reading a colonel's perspective on Desert Storm might be useful if I was about to conduct a ground war on a different continent, where's my morally unambiguous ground war? It's hard to apply that to the seemingly endless, but small things that I experience every day. And also, simply speaking, I don't have a lot of time to read books, so I have to be very specific with what I read. And so while it might not teach me how to flank a machine gun nest better, but reading Seneca is going to help me be a lot less affected by whatever small chaotic events are going on around me at work, and then focus more on the task at hand. And while it might not make me more efficient about calling in artillery on a column of tanks, reading Camus will help me come to terms with just the small and significant things that might go wrong in a certain day, helping me put myself into a larger perspective of things. I would like to know what you guys think. I'm sorry to those who are disappointed who say I can't give good reading recommendations based on certain colonels and generals, but I hope you consider what I've said, and I'd love to hear your thoughts in the comments.